Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
The internet is full of half-truths and all-out lies. We've all seen them, and many people on social media complaining about it. Here's your chance to show and prove. WorldAfropedia.com is a black-owned and operated encyclopedia. There are several thousand articles, but we need help. We can't uncover all the truth ourselves. So please, join us and become a writer, editor, or blogger for WorldAfropedia.com today. Every little bit counts. We owe it to the future generations to put the truth out there. Visit WorldAfropedia.com, the African-centered encyclopedia, a global database of African knowledge for the purpose of bringing about global African wisdom and understanding. WorldAfropedia.com.
Fred, do the McDonald's menu change.
Big Mac McDLT, a quarter pounder, wisdom tooth, filet of fish, a hamburger, cheeseburger, Happy Meal, McNuggets, tasty golden french fries, regular and larger sizes, salad, chef, a garden, or a chicken salad, oriental, big big breakfast, egg McMuffin, hot hot cakes and sauces, maybe biscuits, bacon, egg and cheese, a sausage, dainty hash browns too, and for dessert, hot apple pies and sundaes, three varieties of sauce or foam, three kinds of shakes and chocolate chip cookies, and to drink a Coca-Cola, Diet Coke and orange drink, Sprite and coffee, decaf too, a low fat milk and orange juice.
So McDonald's, two time great taste, and we get this all at one place.
Good, now do it backwards.
This motherfucker, I'm actually enjoyed playing against and enjoy watching. So I'm actually a fan of this motherfucker.
And you can ask him about who deserved MVP in the McDonald's game.
Yes, I have to get that answer.
If he stamps you, you're good. Because I don't know if I believe it until he, because I didn't watch the game. So if he stamps you.
If Kobe stamps that I should have won MVP in the McDonald's 96 All-American game, somebody needs to send me a trophy.
You know, I tell you what, the first time I ever, I actually ever heard E-40 was at a All-American camp.
Yeah.
We were all hanging out in dorms. Uh-huh. And back then it was nothing but Biggie, Nas,
right? Right? That's
all
it.
That stuff, right?
That's
so
it.
They were playing E-40 and shooting craps. And I'm like, man, what, y'all got to show me. What is this? What's going on right now? You know?
Yeah,
so
that,
it was fun getting to know everybody, you know, and then seeing kind of where we've all gone since then.
Well, you guys played in the McDonald's game together, and Jack has it. You won MVP, right?
No.
You won MVP.
I should have won MVP.
You did win MVP, didn't you?
So, see, I'm glad you said that, Cole. So,
who won MVP?
Shaheen Holloway. He had like 10 turnovers,
oh,
too,
he?
Bro. But you know what got him MVP? Remember the bounce pass to Lester Earl,
yeah,
and he dunked on Voss?
Yeah. Yeah.
I think that was the big play. But I led the game in scoring. I actually was 8 for 10 from the field, 3 for 3 from the 3-point line. But our team,
yeah,
me, you, Rip, Jermaine O'Neal, and Shaheen Holloway.
Yeah.
Crazy starting five.
That's crazy. I thought you did win MVP.
No, I didn't.
So he loves the fact that you thought he should have.
But he said that. That's all I wanted to hear.
He wanted that.
All I wanted to hear.
We talked about this before. He's like, Shaheen Holloway won, but Kobe knows I should have won.
I thought you did.
I did. Shaheen won it.
Yeah. Oh, damn.
What's up, Jay?
What up?
Where's Kev?
At the J-O-B, man.
What?
He's still flipping those burgers at Mickey D's?
Thanks, Calvin.
He says he has a plan, man.
Meet the newest member of our management team, Calvin.
Congratulations.
Right.
Don't worry
about my boy,
too. Oh. Yo, Calvin.
May we help you?
Not much, man.
Well, I'm out.
Hey, yo, Calvin.
Now, what's the word on that job thing?
Not for me.
For a friend of mine.
Word.
And the other kids got McDonald's. They outside going, we got McDonald's, hamburgers, McDonald's, McDonald's. I got McDonald's.
Context of white supremacy. Gus T Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Monday, February 24th, 2020. So I have been told, given the subject matter for today, I would be remiss for about a billion reasons if I did not start off with saying the COWS 2020 Counter-Racist Yoga Retreat, the deadline to register is Saturday, February 29. The retreat, we are going to Toronto, May 21 through May 24. No McDonald's there, no chicken nuggets, no burgers, all plant-based meals. Yoga every day, We will be doing food workshops, how you can prepare veggies. If you eat a lot of fast food, if you grew up eating McDonald's, I was a chicken nugget fiend myself. We will go over ways that you can prepare fruits, vegetables that you will enjoy that are delicious. You will forget there was ever such a thing as a quarter pounder or French fries or whatever it is. May 21 through May 24, Toronto, again, plant-based meals, yoga every day, counter-racist workshops, food workshops. Looking forward to having a grand time. Drop an email if you have questions, need more information. No McDonald's there. Now, broadcast for today. Reading is more important than watching television for a variety of reasons. And so much overlap. So excited to get to the details. The audio segment that you heard at the beginning. So many different little intersections about the McDonald's franchise. We got a couple different commercials. We got the fraternity step crew doing the McDonald's menu really fast at the beginning. I think that's from like the 80s, about 30 years ago. Next, we had an interview with Kobe Bryant. I'll pause because they did the farewell to Kobe Bryant today. Our timing impeccable at the Cows. So they did the farewell tribute to Kobe Bryant in Los Angeles today. He, his daughter, the other victims who perished in the helicopter crash. Days before that helicopter crash last month, the interview that you heard took place where they were talking about the McDonald's All-American game from 25 years ago and debating who won MVP, who should have won MVP, and all of the legends from that team and where they ended up at. That interview was literally days before the helicopter crash where they were talking about, with a lot of enthusiasm, a McDonald's All-American game from 25 years ago. Next, we heard the Calvin commercial, infamous. Dave Chappelle spoofed it on his segment from a while back when I posted this segment and I shared the Calvin commercial. A lot of folks reminisced, like, oh, I remember that. I remember that. Where is Calvin now? And then we ended with Eddie Murphy from Raw, although I could have pulled a segment from Coming to America because that is mentioned in the book and there are a lot of goofy lines there. But the entrenchment of McDonald's with regards to black people in the United States, fascinating. The book that we're going to examine today goes a long way to explaining that, putting it in context, if you will, that relationship between the McDonald's franchise and black people in this part of the world. Our guest, she is a Provost's Distinguished Associate Professor of History and African American Studies at Georgetown University. She is a scholar of African American life and culture. The book we are discussing, Franchise, The Golden Arches in Black America, basically hot off the presses, brand new. Should be easy to nab if you want to go out and add something to your reading list for 2020. So glad to have her with us. Joining us live, Dr. Marcia Chatelain. Dr. Chatelain, you with us?
Yes, I am. Hello.
Thank you so much for sharing a bit of your Monday evening. As I said, the book hot off the presses. She's doing a massive book tour promoting her phenomenal work, and just thankful she could share a bit of her time to discuss some of the material with us. For listeners, I'm sure for some folks, this is their first time hearing about the book and you. If we could start, if you could kind of give just brief information about who you are, the work you do, anything you think would be important for folks to know about you.
Absolutely. So I am a professor of African American life and culture, like you said. My first book was Southside Girls Growing Up in the Great Migration, and that looks at the role that girls and young women played in the mass mobilization of black folks from the South to northern cities like Chicago. Chicago is where I grew up, and I was inspired to write a book about the relationship between black folks and McDonald's because, like many people growing up in the 1980s, I went to McDonald's quite a bit. But I also recognize that as a black person growing up in America, I often noticed the incredible influence of black franchise owners on community programs and community events, whether they were sponsoring the local back-to-school parade, whether it was the fact that my first engagement with Black history was through a Black History Month Quiz Bowl show that was underwritten by Black franchise owners, or the fact that I knew many people in college who got scholarships because they worked at a Black franchise McDonald's. I was always really fascinated by this incredible presence of this brand that a lot of people eat at, but what McDonald's means in Black communities is so distinct that I thought it was worth looking into, and that's why I wrote this book.
Know Your Heritage almost had a little audio snippet of that in as well. The trivia show, I believe she's referencing that.
Are you from Chicago too?
No, I am not. I do my homework. Okay. I try to be prepared. But they do have it online. If people want to see Know Your Heritage, you can go online mm-hmm. and see some of the clips from the days when this aired. For our listeners who've not seen you, you're a Black female.
Yes, I am.
Grand. This program, I use the term racism and the term white supremacy. I use them as synonyms. I use the same definition for both terms. The definition mm-hmm. I use is as follows. A global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think such a system exists? Do you think that definition is accurate?
Oh boy, does a system like this exist. I mean, I think we see its manifestations all around us. You know, I think we are at a point right now, especially in this country, where people who have been soothed by the idea that white supremacy was either suppressed at some moment or no longer exists are seeing the ways that it is able to shapeshift and adapt for the time. So I think it's important for us to really reflect on the various ways that white supremacy finds new ways to express itself, even in the face of ideas about progress or change.
So important to keep what Dr. Chatelain just said. Keep that in mind. Is it Chatelain or Chatelain? Make sure I'm saying it.
Chatelain.
Chatelain. Thank you. Dr. Chatelain, what she just said. Keep that in mind in the context of this book, the McDonald's franchise, and applicable to many other areas of people activity. Things can look like progress. They use that term a lot. Things can look like progress. Still system of racism, white supremacy. One thing I want to say, well, it relates to the book. You already mentioned it somewhat, but there are so much connect. As we just said, there's so many connections in the system of white supremacy. There's so much overlap. If you listen chronologically, so we just finished Harriet A. Washington, A Terrible Thing to Waste. They talked about environmental racism. So I was surprised she mentioned fast food as a part of environmental racism for a lot of different reasons. And she talked about them being concentrated in Black areas. So we just finished that Thursday. Now we're doing this book today. Next, or this coming Thursday, we are starting Chicago. We are starting Packing Them In, an archaeology of environmental racism in Chicago, 1865 to 1954 by Sylvia Hood Washington. That's for Thursday on the Book Club, Chicago. You'll see the connect when we get there. I don't know if McDonald's will be mentioned in that book, but that's coming up. Are you familiar with that work, Dr. Chatelain?
I'm familiar with the first book that you mentioned, but not the last one. And I think this idea, when we think about environmental issues, when we think about environmental racism, we often think about really overt acts of, you know, dumping chemical waste or putting housing near factories. But, you know, when we think about the totality of the environment, it's about access to healthy food. It's about noise pollution. It's about exposure to a lot of traffic. It's about development policies that don't make sure that homes have the proper lead abatement. And so within the context of, you know, where fast food restaurants are able to be built quickly, and where that traffic goes when fast food is brought into a neighborhood, is an issue that in my book, Black communities were fighting in the 70s. They were making environmental claims against McDonald's long before people were aware of the issues of cattle and how much land that takes up. Before people were talking about styrofoam, a lot of black communities were fighting against McDonald's based on quality of life in their neighborhoods. And that was something that was so important for me to expose, to show that there has always been a long tradition of thoughtful organizing around quality of life in black communities.
Super important. Thursday, reading more important than watching television, packing them in, an archaeology of environmental racism in Chicago. 1860, that was the thing that really caught my attention with all the Greta Thunberg and this is 21st century, that this is environmental racism, 1865 to 1954.
Mm-hmm.
Whew, looking forward to, oh, go ahead, sorry.
Oh, yeah, and just the issue of density, right? One of the consequences of housing segregation and segregation in general is you have density in areas where people are allowed to live because there's so many areas they're not allowed to live, and that density creates this, you know, higher rates of the spread of disease, people having lack of access to, you know, parks, and you start to see the consequences, right? When the built environment is designed to contain people, under these conditions, that's how you have these environmental risks.
Wow. Just want to remind people again, there is a reason. She asked me if I'm from Chicago. I have said we have done the cows for 11 years. I've been in Seattle, Washington the entire time. I always reference it as the greatest plantation I have been to.
Wow.
I had to hurt my brain a little bit thinking at different places that I've lived in Seattle, like, where's the McDonald's? Where's the McDonald's? Like, I had to actually go on Google Maps to find, like, I know there's one downtown, but once we get past that, like, oof, I was a little pressed to be able to find them. Not, I mean, I am vegan now. I've been vegan for 2 years, but I have been a meat eater for a long time in Seattle. I could point out other, you know, restaurants and chains and things of that nature. They don't have those McDonald's just everywhere. In fact, they don't have fast food restaurants like that just anywhere in Seattle. They don't have Walmarts in Seattle proper. They don't have plastic bags even in Seattle. Like a totally different environment where you have very few black people in Seattle. Anywho, one quick question I did want to ask, since you said Chicago, are you familiar with Dr. Frances Kress-Welsing? She's also a Chicago native.
Yes, I am.
Wow. The ISIS papers, have you read? Oh, okay.
These are, yeah, classic texts. Right. And, you know, Chicago is such an important city because of Third World Press and Haki Mabudi and just the idea of creating, you know, literary channels for people to publish their work is such an important part of Chicago history.
Mm. Franchise, The Golden Arches in Black America. I was, how shall I phrase it? It was striking. I had heard interviews about your book. I had read some of the reviews and things. And then I open up, I start reading, and I get to the beginning, and it's Ferguson. And I said, whoa, I wasn't thinking that. And then I remembered, I started to read a little bit, but it only took a few seconds. My memory isn't that bad. 2014 is not that long ago. And I said, oh yeah, they were having, that was the spot to go get milk to get the tear gas out of your eyes. And that was the spot to go charge your cell phone. And you talked about even some of the journalists got arrested. Michael Brown Jr. killed by enforcement officials and the subsequent protests that went on for weeks, months, really. Why did you pick that as the starting point for Franchise?
In many ways, I felt like it was the proper bookend because the start of McDonald's coming into black neighborhoods started after Dr. Martin Luther King's assassination in 1968. And one of the things I realized in researching this book is when we have these moments of civil unrest that are a response to the kind of white supremacist violence, you know, you're talking about, whether it's King's assassination or the killing of Michael Brown, the uprisings happen. And what is often delivered to communities that are in a lot of stress and a lot of struggle aren't relief from the conditions of white supremacy. It's often an invitation to start a bit for business. And that business invitation came to the fast food industry after 68. And I thought there was a kind of cruel irony that the McDonald's in Ferguson was the anchor in this moment in crisis, because that McDonald's is also franchised by a black franchise owner. And so in many ways, chaos brings more capitalism into black communities. And I'm really moved by Naomi Klein's work on disaster capitalism. And it's this idea in these moments where there's great either unrest in the streets or environmental disasters or natural disasters like Hurricane Katrina, once the dust settles, it becomes a wide open space for the disruption of public resources and the advancement of capitalist enterprises. So that McDonald's in Ferguson, you know, is in the background, but I think for me it epitomizes the long tensions of how communities get relief from the conditions they're fighting against.
Excellent bookend with the assassination of Dr. King, which you talk about in the book. And in fact, it just becomes almost we talk about patterns. Dr. Welsing talked so frequently about patterns within the system of white supremacy, where you can see the repetition with the assassination of Dr. King, the upheaval in 1992 after the beating of Rodney King. You talk about that in the book. And then starting off with Michael Brown Jr., you get to see it repeatedly in a lot of the same response. In fact, that's repeated in the book where they talk about some of the uprisings in 1919, and then they get to the 60s. You see a lot of the same patterns in the system.
Absolutely.
of white supremacy. You just mentioned it with capital, and you'll have these incidents of disruption, the King assassination, where you had a lot of property damage in areas with black people, where stores were burned down. You have light, empty lots and things of that nature, as opposed to we'll come in and have job programs, things that Dr. King was talking about, employment, where you could get substantial jobs and education. We'll do fast food. And you talk about how the civil rights movement, so-called, gets tied to, hey, black capitalism, borrow Jesse Jackson's phrase, silver rights, and how that gets kind of tied in with the expansion of the McDonald's franchise. Can you kind of talk about how that vision of Dr. King, I have a dream, gets overlaid to, hey, franchise, that's the dream?
Yeah, so after King's assassination, there's this kind of question about what direction is a movement going to take and who is going to succeed Dr. King. And one of the ways that the movement has to kind of grapple with this idea of what's next is people had endured these incredibly emotionally volatile experiences of having won some federal victories with the Civil Rights Act of 64 and the Voting Rights of 1965. Right after King's assassination, we have the passage of the Fair Housing Act of 1968. So legislation is moving, but nothing is changing in the quality of people's lives. And so in that disconnect, in that chasm, the enthusiasm for black capitalism is intriguing, because what it says is you can finally see the fruits of your labor of struggle. Because if a black-owned business opens, if you have an opportunity to open a business, you know, you might forget all of the other promises of the movement victories if you have this thing. And so you've got this kind of pressure for people to invest into this idea that the movement is going to grow up, that we're going to stop talking about integration and beloved community, and we're just going to make some money. And while it might sound cynical the way I put it out, I'm incredibly sympathetic to why people feel this way, because they're so grief-stricken over King's loss and the country is falling into chaos. And so people are cleaving to this idea of civil rights, which Jesse Jackson presents as the next developmental step for a movement that needs to grow up. So you see all of this encouragement for people to abandon the ideas of anti-racism and embrace capitalism, which is wild when you think of, you know, the very last words that King uttered in Memphis when he's talking about black economic power. He's not talking about it to spend money, right? He's talking about it to withhold financial resources for companies that are not respecting workers. He's talking about being in solidarity with sanitation workers. But the message becomes business at all costs. And so you in that void, here comes Richard Nixon, and he's saying, listen, I can give you black capitalism, and it brings all of these different people together at the table who are deciding this is the direction the movement needs to go into.
this ties with McDonald's. In fact, I can just read from your book. This is chapter two. You write, you're talking about a former professional basketball player who begins buying McDonald's franchises and turning a nice profit. You write, his store's success reflected the research findings on black people and fast food. By 1972, one study found that in poor black neighborhoods, the cheap mass-produced food was more than a snack. It was generally constituted an all-purpose meal. Not surprisingly, a disproportionate number of ghetto stands belong to Hamburger Central's Million Dollar Club, the restaurants which do over $1 million a year in business. Black stores, as they were called, on average, grossed 25% more profits than white stores. Throughout the 1970s, market research reports found that black men displayed a tendency to eat at McDonald's more than any other demographic, black male privilege. Blacks were also more likely to be heavy users, meaning they consumed McDonald's food at least once a week and tended to spend more money than whites on fast food. Although the data indicated that McDonald's was doing well with blacks, their studies cautioned that black customers generally display more use of vulnerability to competition, so they required concentrated efforts to maintain their loyalties. Whew. Heard that phrase a few times about black people's loyalties, but can you talk about some of the efforts that begin going, those concentrated efforts to get black people's loyalties, both in taking advantage of the blight after Dr. King? We can take advantage, we can get cheap property and move into these areas with our stores under the, hey, this is part of the dream, jobs and all of that. And also the concentrated efforts in the advertisements slowly begin to eke out to black people in the 1970s.
Absolutely. So the first, pivot point of the fast food industry into black communities was the fact that McDonald's, for instance, purchases the property in which it establishes its businesses. So it was able to take advantage of the fact that property values had plummeted in some parts of urban America because of uprisings. So they're buying cheaper land. Even when they don't build new stores, stores that are abandoned by white franchise owners are assumed by black entrepreneurs. And so they are able to mitigate their losses, because if a store is damaged in an uprising, they can find a black franchise owner to turn that store around and to make high profits. They're also benefiting from the fact that there was a lot of white economic flight in those neighborhoods. We often think of white flight as associated with housing and its impacts on real estate revenues and schools, but people forget that a lot of people close their businesses as well. And so with the departure of white-owned businesses in black communities, you also had a departure of more market options. So while black America is feeling the squeeze of fewer and fewer choices, McDonald's is filling all of these voids. And to maintain that market loyalty and to keep those customers, to patronize their stores, they're recruiting more black franchise owners. So people are feeling a little bit better about going to McDonald's because they're buying black. Then they're doing these very sophisticated marketing campaigns that are targeting black audiences. And then they go and they spend a lot of time ensuring that they are doing menu adaptations or doing everything they can to keep the black customer happy. And so all of these things are happening behind the scenes. And I think it's very easy for people to say, wow, why were people just going to McDonald's? It's like the environment was ripe in which McDonald's was the sensible, best, and most economic choice for a lot of people.
I think that's so important. You talk about that towards the end, but when you have the absence or the white flight of businesses, and so now you have fewer options, and as opposed to chastising, you know, why are you buying this? Or why are you eating this food? Why are you all, you know, jumping on McDonald's and fast food, as opposed to, oh, wait a minute, you don't have grocery stores here. Mm-hmm. Oh, I see. You have very limited and very limited finances. So the double whammy, they even talked about that in some, where you're talking about if you're only getting social service benefits and that sort of thing, then you don't really have a whole lot of work with anyway. And then you have very limited choices as well. If folks have questions, comments, the number 605-313-5133. 564, the code 564943 pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. You talked about in some of these areas they would get a black franchisee. You can come in. A white owner might not want to be in this area anyway, if it's been uprisings or what have you. Fine. You can come in, and at least it looks like it's owned by a black person. That, you know, is talked about in great detail. We can get some of the detail of that as well. But we'll have this black person here. You point out another component of the racism in the book is you put this black person in these franchises that a lot of times they are in dilapidated areas. There might be security problems. The insurance might be astronomical. Like, can you talk about, I mean, they said, hey, this is racism here because you're confining us to putting into these really dilapidated McDonald's stores.
Yeah, I mean, it gets really complicated because I think that you have people who are really pulled in so many directions. On one hand, you have a consumer base that wants to buy black, that wants to do the ethical thing and believe that through purchasing, they're reinvesting in their communities. And then you have these entrepreneurs who they are motivated by making money, but they also want to do something in their community. You know, they're not without any sense of kind of civic responsibility. Then you have McDonald's that's able to set so many terms of business that put these franchise owners in these really difficult to manage situations, and they have the pressure not only to perform by McDonald's standards, but to also be active and thoughtful members of their communities. And so when they start to charge McDonald's with accusations of redlining, of confining them in communities where it's harder and harder to make a profit, you know, initially McDonald's response is, well, don't you want to do business in your community? Isn't this what you asked for? You know, kind of like be grateful. And it really does show you that under capitalism, no matter how wealthy you are or how successful you are under its own terms, you will never fully be able to enjoy the power of capitalism because of racism. And I think there's something really both eye-opening and sometimes even poignant the way that these franchise owners are really trying their best to try to make this happen and make it work, but it's not a system that is designed to really do something equitable.
Hugely important point. I agree. I want to get back to black owned. That's so input. Definitions are so important. Wowee, black owned. That comes up repeatedly in the text. You have a great quote from one of my former instructors, Julian Bond, legend in the so-called civil rights movement, now passed on, or his summation. In America, there were few truly black businesses. Between the time the first business plan was drafted and the moment the first profit collected, one could encounter white financiers, white franchising representatives, white federal agency heads, or white French fry distribution company owners. If one could not buy black authentically, then the very least a black customer could do was look for a product tinged with soul. I thought that was so poignant. These are all your words, but wow. That is, I feel like we do Workplace Racism Weekly. I could read this every Thursday because we talk about this all the time in a system of racism, white supremacy. It is not impossible to have a truly black-owned business with the number of white people who will have authority over whether or not you will operate that bookstore, lemon stand, McDonald's franchise, fill in the blank of whatever you can think of. A whole lot of white people who have a lot of power will have a lot to say about your quote-unquote black-owned business. Your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, and I think that, you know, again, this is something that I'm super sympathetic with people. You know, you want to do the right thing, but I think all of this points to the fact that when you're dealing in a system of capital, the right thing will always be limited by the fact that capitalism needs to be fed on profits. It needs to be fed on extracting, financial capital at all without any kind of consideration for people. And so buying black is an important principle, and it is not necessarily going to be the key to liberation. And I think that that's what's so hard for a lot of people to really grasp during this period of time because they're very hopeful that owning franchises, by investing in franchises, they can field some, they can enjoy some of the gains of these profits, but that's not what that system is designed to do. And so people become very frustrated. They get very discouraged. But one of the things that, you know, I wish in some of these anecdotes I write about, I could whisper in everyone's ear, you know, the system is rigged. It's not going to do the things that you want it to do. And it's not because you're weak or because you're not committed. It's because by design, it will not allow you to do these things.
By design, underline, highlight. I feel you. I feel like I hear some of these same thoughts today in 2020. Like, oh my goodness! Like we should have. Well, we should be more informed. That's why books like this are important. Reading is more important than watching television. You write. I thought that, and this is that concentrated targeting of Black people and the dangers of. You can do a lot of things. You said tinged with soul. We use the term on this broadcast, racial showcasing, Neely Fuller Jr.'s work, where they can put a Black person out front to give the appearance that, oh, yeah, this is a Black owned business. Or at least we got Black people that are, you know, majorly in charge and operating. And often that's not the case at all. There are a lot of things that can be done to fake that appearance. You write Sisters, ERS version, Sisters. Chicken and Biscuits, full name, was still in experimentation stage of the restaurant concept in 1981, and they had not established any minority franchising initiative. They did clarify that they were interested in local people operating stores, did not want to franchise to cooperatives or development groups, and they wanted people with significant experience in fast food. Franchising aside, the word sister was an issue of contention whether the name of the restaurant was to reflect Black modes of addressing Black women, or, as a co-owner suggested, the main concept of the name Sisters was to do with chicken you would eat on your sister's front porch. The
editor- that doesn't even make sense.
Why doesn't that make sense?
I mean, what do you? I mean, it's so obviously trying to get a mode, a tone, by saying we're going to have a Sister's Chicken and Biscuit in a Black neighborhood. Why do you have to be on someone's porch? Who has a tradition of eating chicken on your sister's porch? Like, that's not even a thing.
The appeal to Black, I mean, they already have the research. Like, wow. And you had, there was some timidity about opening franchises in Black areas. It may... We might think of KFC as a chicken behemoth. That was not the case. You know, 50, 60 years ago, there was some slowness about going into these. You still had a lot of, I guess, what the mom and pop stands owned by Black people where they would do fried chicken or catfish, whatever, depending on, you know, the region. You still had a lot of that. There was some reluctance. And in fact, you talk about McDonald's was kind of the avant-garde, so to speak, in saying, hey, we will go aggressively after these Black dollars, yes?
Absolutely. So, you know, before King's assassination, when Ray Kroc was kind of laying out his plans for where McDonald's would go, you know, he would pick the suburbs. He would pick bedroom communities, places with emerging strip malls and shopping malls, you know, the family-friendly places, places that, you know, land near churches, places where people would go. And it wasn't until these uprisings, when they started to experiment with Black franchise ownership and they saw how successful it was, that they were really willing to take on Black communities. And they were the first to target them, to bring in the Black franchise owners, and their success was immediate. And that's when the other companies, you see Burger King and then later Taco Bell and KFC doing similar work and really seeing that if you segment the Black market and you bring in Black franchise owners, you can make lots of money.
Context of white supremacy, our guest, Dr. Marcia Chatelain, discussing her book, Franchise. Wow. I wanted to talk about Tom Burrell. He wrote the book Brainwashed, and how he participated in some of the advertising marketing McDonald's to Black people. I just wanted to read a quick passage from Franchise. You write, this is after talking about this McDonald's commercial for a beefsteak sandwich, where you have this Black couple on a bus, and the Black bus driver says, yeah, if you got a steak size appetite, but a hamburger wallet, get this beefsteak sandwich. And so you write, the man's dress belied his financial status, an outward sign of a piece of marketing common sense that was often applied to black people. Appearance is everything, and overcompensation was critical. Market research designed to tap into the hearts and minds of black America assumed that black consumer self-consciousness was central to how blacks interacted with buying toothpaste, choosing a burger, or singing in a lease on a luxury, or signing a lease on a luxury car. I actually want to stop right there. I do want to continue with the rest, but just that right there is fascinating. Do you have thoughts on that?
I mean, it's painful. I think it's really poignant because, you know, this reminded me of a piece I read years ago in a blog about money. And it was from a young black man who talked about how he had a propensity to overspend, not because he wanted things, but because he felt like he was being profiled in stores. So he felt like he had to prove that he wasn't up to no good, or he wasn't, you know, he did not belong. So he found himself just buying little things and spending money. And in similar ways, when the 1970s market research firms that were devoted to black customers started observing black buying habits, you know, they used to always say, well, black people will do overextend themselves, they will do the most, they will try to do everything they can in engaging with material objects to kind of appear more wealthy and more assimilated if they need to. And it's heartbreaking. It really is. And again, it just shows us the ways that capitalism creates all of these desires in us. And even when we have the means to purchase things, it will never do the thing that we want it to do. And so these market research firm folks, they really knew how to tap into both insecurities, and they were tacitly accepting the fact that this is how racism affects how people interact in their day-to-day lives.
With Mr. Burrell, Chicago, link again, after consumer studies and internal reports assured fast food companies that blacks led among their most frequent customers, they enlisted black franchisees, advertisers, and marketing specialists to grow this reliable base. Chicago-based market research firm Viewpoint Incorporated and advertising agency Burrell Communications facilitated this transition. Viewpoint's studies of black preferences for fast food and Burrell's targeted advertising campaigns worked in concert to keep fast food companies abreast of what black America wanted. I want to read one more little portion, but I just want to pause here. So many times, the reflexive conclusion is that white people are ignorant about racism, ignorant about black people. It sounds like the white people at McDonald's studied black people very well. Maybe I misread.
Very carefully. Very carefully.
Just one more quick sentence. It says, in the race to capture black hearts and minds through targeted marketing and philanthropy, the fast food industry provided a platform for black culture and taste. Man, if I could get 30 seconds, just 30 seconds. She does write about Dr. Chatelain. She does write about coming to America in the book. That's why I said that. We did have Eddie Murphy in the intro. I could have swapped it out and did coming to America. And when I went back and looked at it, it's like, oh, yeah, that's yeah, okay, okay. So I could have put that in. And she talked about the reason why, because some of the kind of goofy scenes where they do like the talent show and things, some of that did happen. And it would be a black franchisee who would be sponsoring the event, if it's a talent show or singing event or whatever the case may be, that this, you know, is based in truth, even though this is a fictional, obviously, movie. Pause. So in preparation for the program today, I was posting McDonald's commercials, Calvin, and just going through Michael Jordan, lots of them. So I get, after I've posted a bunch of them, a listener posts a flyer for McDonald's Gospel Fest 2020. Mm-hmm.
I had never even heard of this. Like, what is going on? Yeah. 38 years, no less. This is 40. So I go online and I check out some of the footage. Man, it looked exactly like Coming to America. Oh. Like, I was wounded a little bit. Like, oh no. Like, it was painfully similar to Coming to America, but philanthropy. 38 years of Gospel Fest. Can you talk about, I mean, the fruits of Tom Burrell viewpoint, can you talk about the fruits of their labor?
Yeah, I mean, both of the brains behind these initiatives were very much this idea that they were in the business of not only getting information about Black consumers, but providing back to them images and ideas to make them comfortable with these brands that had previously neglected them or even demeaned them. And so, you know, Viewpoint is really fascinating because they get so much information on not just McDonald's, but Popeyes and KFC. They do a lot of brand awareness. And the key to understanding the Black consumer in the 70s and 80s is understanding a person who has long felt outside of institutions, outside of the country, but also so central to its cultural life. So on one hand, you know, they're trying to find ways for this group of people to feel comfortable going into restaurants because for so much of the consumer history of Black folks, they've been kept out of public places. But in the same tune, they're using R&B and jazz and then later rap and hip hop music because Black folks have been at the center of so much of the cultural innovation of the country, right? And so it's in that contradiction that a lot of the marketing and a lot of the themes that we see in commercials targeting Black America comes forward. And so they are tasked with translating Black America to corporate America in order to make them, you know, the prime targets of these various campaigns. And they're so successful at it because they understand that subtle nuance of how to make Black folks feel comfortable in spaces that may have been exclusionary in the past.
The commercials are fascinating, as I said, just posting them and listeners remembering. And I mean, So, looking at commercials that came out within like the last 5 years, commercials that came out 30, 40, 50 years ago. I looked at the one that you talked about in the book. They had the family, entire Black family, Black grandmother, and they're going to be late for church. And she's all upset like, oh, we're going to be late and you're not even going to have breakfast. And they go to McDonald's and she's going to get an Egg McMuffin and she's all skeptical. And then she enjoys it and they rejoice. And it's got the gospel music in the background. Like, wow. Can you talk about, because the one that resonated for a lot of listeners was the Calvin commercials for folks who haven't seen, if you're maybe a little younger. This is like in the 90s, and it's a series where they have a Black male. He's like a late teen, and he's kind of being teased as he's walking through the neighborhood by the Black people like, hey, what are you doing? Blah, blah, blah. And it turns out he's working at McDonald's, and they do a number of these different commercials. Can you just talk about the significance of that series?
Yeah, Calvin was really, really important in the marketing of McDonald's. And I talked to someone who had worked on the Calvin ad. And what he explained to me was the reason they put that out is because it was during the time where a lot of sociologists and a lot of social critics were incredibly critical of McDonald's jobs. And the term McJob had been coined, and people were really looking at fast food as a dead-end opportunity. And so much of McDonald's marketing to Black folks was this idea that McDonald's was employing Black youth, they were doing scholarships, and it was a place where you could work up the ranks. And so Calvin is interesting because the first Calvin story is supposed to be Calvin is in the hood, and you don't know if Calvin is good or bad. His jeans are baggy, and he's like around the block, and he seems to know some of the dudes, and he's going somewhere, and you don't know where he's supposed to go. And it's at the end of the commercial when they do the big reveal, when he turns his cap over, because he had a backwards cap, and it says, "Welcome to McDonald's, how may I help you?" That, you know, Calvin's really a good one. He's a good kid. And then the follow-up commercials were about Calvin doing well, and then the last one in the series was a group of people gossiping in the neighborhood that Calvin owns a McDonald's because he's doing so well. So you start to see the themes of, you know, a McDonald's job will give you discipline, that they are a place in these neighborhoods where young black men could go in a number of directions, and so McDonald's is a positive influence. And then it's like, Calvin can aspire to one day be a franchise owner if he works hard and focuses on his McDonald's dreams. And so those commercials really encapsulate a lot of the ways that in the 90s, McDonald's was trying to do what a lot of culture makers were doing with these kind of like working class and poor black life is depicted in popular culture, but then subverting that to make sure you're comfortable with Calvin, to know that he's hardworking and industrious, as if those two qualities were mutually exclusive, as if poor people don't work hard, or if people in the hood aren't industrious. And so you start to see the real kind of racial logics of how that representation is critical for the brand and how they talk to black consumers.
Mm. There was a commercial, this is from like the early 2000s, and this has like a black athlete or entertainer of some sort. He's not in a suit. He's got on like some sort of jumper suit, and he has cornrows. And so he's going into a mansion, and he's got a white butler. And so he goes in, he's got like all these people just laid out all over his house, and he has like a trough of Egg McMuffins and yes, coffee that he delivers to everyone. It's just like, I mean, you talk about the representation, and how do we think of it's that's that fella, even though he has a lot of money, he's got this big McMansion and everything. This cornrowed black male is not very far removed from all of those black males who are ridiculing. Where are you going, Calvin? He is not very far removed from them at all, even though he has all this wealth. And you've seen that commercial, I take it. Yes,
I know exactly what you're talking about.
Got it. Got it. The other thing your book made me think about in terms of how McDonald's, why we think of them as being such an entrenched part of quote unquote black culture and having such a connection to black people. I said, Kobe Bryant, they did the farewell today. Mm-hmm. I'm willing to wager a lot of money. You will not have to look very hard to find pictures of Kobe Bryant, All-American game. I posted one. I didn't have to look hard. I posted, I think, two or three of them. I could have had my choice. I had never even thought of the All-American game and the significance. I mean, talk about a winner. Whoever came up with that,
yeah.
Wow, brilliant. I mean, any black basketball player of any significance for the last 20 years, any black male or female basketball player of any significance at the high school level at all, and any black male basketball player for at least 40 years, Michael Jordan, Shaquille O'Neal,
Magic
Kevin
Johnson,
Durant, exactly, Zion Williamson, we can go as current as you want, Candace Parker,
mm-hmm,
Kobe Bryant, they all wore that golden arch. My goodness, like the just that event, you can go and find Ronald McDonald. I saw him posing with Kevin Durant. He had the MVP, and Ronald McDonald was right there. Just that event alone. And you can go on YouTube and watch that entire game with Zion Williamson. They have the whole game. I think that's the 2018. You can see that whole game on YouTube. Just the significance of that event alone.
Yeah, I mean, I think those are the types of things where McDonald's is hiding in plain sight. And so, you know, in a pre-YouTube world, those games are really important for scouting, for attention. You know, I talk about the Double Dutch Leagues that McDonald's sponsored, and a lot of these programs were youth programs designed to kind of keep kids out of trouble, to be a community outreach. But in and of themselves, those became their own kind of lucrative industries, these basketball games. And so you start to see, especially, it's funny you bring up the gospel music thing, because the gospel music circuit is really indebted to a lot of the fast food companies. Kentucky Fried Chicken had one. Quaker Oats also sponsored it. That was a big way to try to get older black customers, is to do the gospel music circuit. I mean, McDonald's was doing things with the Negro Playwright Theater in Harlem. Like, this is, you know, they really put the resources in those places where they felt like Black people had really positive associations.
Context of white supremacy. They even sponsored a trip to West Africa at one point. Is that accurate?
Yes, that is true. It was tied to Alex Haley's roots. When Roots had like a second, there was a second Roots movie, I think in the early 90s. And there was a trip to West Africa sweepstakes. And you can meet, I believe, members of the Haley family. And that, you know, that's not a small thing. If you think about the impact of Roots and genealogy, and again, in a pre-DNA testing kind of world, for a fast food company like McDonald's to say, you know, we're going to help you better understand your roots, it's pretty powerful stuff.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You mentioned Roots and Alex Haley. They're being a chicken franchise named Chicken George, black-owned chicken franchise that was, you know, successful for a time. But again, in a system of racism, white supremacy, same thing I said, it's very hard. And hey, if you are successful, very powerful white people might say, hey, we can take over this market. And that's what happened with Chicken George. And you write, the void left by Chicken George was filled by an amended Kentucky Fried Chicken chain that targeted inner city locations. In the early 1990s, Kentucky Fried Chicken unveiled 27 neighborhood stores, which appears to have been code for black. Diners could decide among the Colonel's traditional recipe chicken and biscuits, or red beans and rice, mean greens, macaroni and cheese, and finish off lunch or dinner with Southern favorites, peach cobbler or sweet potato pie. We had vegan sweet potato pie at the Florida Counter-Racist Retreat. In Detroit, the newly renamed KFC presented restaurants that offered the locally made Mr. Fofo's sweet potato pie. A press release explained that the new crew uniforms would include African kufis hats and kente cloth accented dashikis. KFC explained the uniforms evoke the proud heritage of an African Americans to whom neighborhood KFCs are targeted. While eating honey barbecue wings or hot and spicy chicken in Baltimore, Atlanta, Boston, Chicago, New York, Detroit, and Philadelphia, notice they didn't mention Seattle, customers could listen to tunes likely to be found on local urban radio stations. The greens were test marketed in the early 1980s, and some speculated it was a response to the popularity of Chicken George's collards side dish. KFC had traditionally tested well with black consumers, but the neighborhood concept was the most explicit adoption of foods and reconfiguring of the in-store dining experience in the direction of black customers. Had Holmes decided to use his experiences in business to simply franchise one of Chicken George's competitors, his story may have ended much differently. Fast forwarding just to your concluding thought there, was in the fast food franchise world, making a good product or simply being black owned was not enough. The name of fast food game was capital, and without it, a new restaurant could disappear as quickly as a two-piece chicken meal. I thought all of that was super important, and again, just getting back to, in a system of racism, white supremacy, black-owned business can be undermined pretty quickly, yes? As quickly as a two-piece meal, yes?
Absolutely. I mean, you have these examples of people who have good products, like Chicken George's, like you, they have popularity, they're actually gaining market share. But the second that the competitors see that and they're providing discount coupons, they're able to open four stores when you're only able to open two, you will be eviscerated. And I wanted to talk about Chicken George's because in many ways I felt like that was the last kind of effort to do a grassroots black-owned franchise concept. And although there are other black-owned franchises, concepts like, you know, Golden Crust, which is Caribbean, you know, that opportunity was completely closed by the early 1990s because they had learned the ins and outs of marketing to this population, and they had the financial ability to just stay in the game and take some losses. And so it's a particular poignant story about the way that this kind of last effort towards black capitalism just kind of you know, collapsed.
I so appreciated in the text you talk about how frequently when a black owned business collapses, even a lot of black people will say black people don't support black businesses. Mm-hmm. We just, you know, we spend, we don't circulate dollars amongst our own. And you talk about in the book that, hey, that is not supported by fact. Can you explain?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is the thing. People will say, well, folks aren't supporting business. And that's actually not the case. People are supporting black-owned businesses. It's just their competitors often can outspend and outpace them. And I think that the pressure on the black-owned business is what really concerns me. I want to live in a world where business is just a place that sells hamburgers. But unfortunately, in a black community, a restaurant has to also be a community benefactor. It also has to deal with the fact that it will not have access to loans and capital like its white counterparts. It has to deal with the fact that if they are in a black neighborhood, then their cost of doing business is higher. And so people are supporting these businesses, but these businesses exist at such a early disadvantage that catching up is almost impossible.
Context of White Supremacy. Again, our guest, Dr. Marcia Chatelain. The number 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. I think our caller in Seattle here. Did you have a question for Dr. Chatelain? You should be with us.
Greetings, Gus.
Greetings.
Can I be heard?
Yes, yes, we can hear you.
Thank you for bringing this excellent book to my attention. Greetings, Professor Chatelain.
Hi.
The book really resonated with me because I've actually eaten in two of the McDonald's that you talked about. The first was the one in Cleveland on Kinsman, and actually I was one of the people, one of the teenagers trying to cross the picket line for David Hill.
Really?
During that time. Yes. I remember it distinctly. We were trying to get through the drive-through, and his group was out there picketing. Suffice to say, I never made it through the drive-through. But in any event, he was a very curious person, and probably one of the reasons why I went out and purchased your book. The question I have is, he, I guess, was indicted, and then he went, became a fugitive, mm-hmm. and wound up in Guyana.
Mm-hmm.
This is stuff I've gotten off the internet. He alleged that he was supported by the U.S. government down there. Do you have any information, or through your research, or Freedom of Information Act, about how he got to Guyana from East Cleveland?
And, I have.
And I guess how he, you know, because it was an intersection of, it was kind of fascinating to me because he was down there at the same time that Jim Jones was there,
mm-hmm.
and Walter Rodney, the Marxist professor. So do you have any additional information on that?
I have no idea, you know, how he got there. I'm not entirely sure that the federal government, especially since he was under prosecution, helped him go there. He did later work for the head of state of Guyana, but him traveling to Guyana, I guess, wouldn't be that unusual if he knew people who were part of the People's Temple in neighboring Indiana. So I would venture to say he probably had a network of people who were part of the People's Temple maybe before they had moved out to San Francisco, and he linked up with them.
Okay, thank you. My second question was, one of the things that what struck me about your work is the details you gave about black wealth, particularly Brady Keyes.
Mm.
And one of the questions I have, do you have any information on transferring this wealth to the next generation. I don't know if that's clear, but it seems like these franchises and this wealth kind of ends with the person who creates the work, and it never seems to go on to the next generation. I don't know if that makes sense. Question, but
it does. A lot of people are concerned about generational wealth in the franchising industry, because even when you make lots of money as a black franchise owner, it is a lot of work, it's a lot of management, and it's a lot of liability. There was some recent article in Business Insider that said that the number of black franchise owners in the McDonald's system has been declining because of some of the issues I write about higher costs of business, some of the demands on McDonald's to be open 24 hours a day, to have all-day breakfast, as well as to modernize the stores with the touchscreen computers and all of those types of things, has had an impact on black franchise owners who have a harder time paying for those things and maintaining them. And so while some black franchise owners are wealthy and are able to transfer that wealth to their kids, the big question for them is whether their kids want to stay engaged in that business and generate even more wealth, or would they prefer to cash out and do other things?
And I guess my last question was, two of the statistics that really struck me in your work was that the wealth of McDonald's was really in the land, and that I guess in 1967, they had $100 million worth of land at that time. And the second statistic that struck me was that 83% of the income generated from the franchises went to the parent company. What were your thoughts about that?
Yeah, you know, the land thing, as I was working on the book, I was realizing just how important that was, because when you have land in so many varied parts of the country, it allows you to have a kind of a dominance in the market. Even if people aren't buying your product so much, your assets are just so strong. And then in terms of where the dollars go, this is a very controversial issue in the 70s when people are talking about whether or not it matters if a McDonald's is black franchised or not, if those dollars are actually staying in the community. And if you think about all of the fees associated with franchising, all of the contractors who have to bring in goods and services for the store, you know, other than payroll and some local taxes and philanthropy, a lot of money is going out of the stores. I don't know what those percentages are today, but in the period of time in which people are making this critique of McDonald's in the 1970s, it's part of a concerted effort for people to really think about whether they want lots of fast food in their communities and neighborhoods, and people are attacking it on environmental issues as well as these economic issues.
And my last comment is about, I also was quite familiar with that McDonald's in North Philadelphia, and the one you mentioned about Ogontz.
Oh, yeah.
Avenue. I lived in that neighborhood.
Oh, my gosh.
And went to that McDonald's quite frequently. And, you know, when I was, you know, back in the 80s, and what was interesting, which I noticed, was that it really was essentially a almost like a community center for elderly black men. I mean, they were there every day. The same group of people, and so I had never seen that before. So until I went to that particular establishment. So in any event. Thank you for your excellent work and
thank you for
bringing this to my attention.
Glad it spoke to you.
Thank you.
Much obliged, caller. Before I get our next caller, I had a number of highlights with Brady Keyes. I'll just share a little bit since the caller mentioned him. Brady Keyes was the unofficial spokesperson for Nixon's black capitalism efforts. The former Colorado State University cornerback played football with the Pittsburgh Steelers, garnering all-pro status during his eight-year stint between 1961 and 1969. After leaving the National Football League, Keyes wanted to follow in the footsteps of his teammates and devote himself fully to business. During his football career, Keyes tried to franchise a car dealership and had difficulties securing financing. Banks refused him 10 times, and he needed to leverage a Steelers connection in order to receive his first business loan. Context of white supremacy. I'm skipping down a little bit. National chains took notice of Keyes All-Pro as they were probably keeping tabs on McDonald's inner city campaign and drafted Keyes for their team of black franchisees. In 1969, he met with executives from Miami-based Burger King and took possession of his first burger restaurant, an unprofitable and failing location in inner city Detroit. Like Petty, Keyes was tasked with turning around the store, and after a strong opening year, Keyes acquired his second Burger King. Keyes, like other black franchisees, used his instincts and revised the company's directives in order to turn the tide for his restaurants. He revived waning Whopper sales in 1969 by selling the iconic burgers in his store on a made-to-order basis, which inspired Burger King's "Have It Your Way" tagline of the 1970s. Black Enterprise magazine praised him for developing the innovations that turned his Burger King store into the top-selling store in the nation. Let's see. Our caller, retired firefighter in Florida. If you had a question for Dr. Marcia Chatelain, proceed.
I'm laughing, Gus, because you just answered it. I was going to ask the guests about Mr. Keyes. I knew him as a pretty good football player. But also, in addition, and this is to the guests, there wasn't he the first black person to own a Kentucky Fried Chicken franchise also?
He also did go into KFC franchising. He had a brand called All Pro Chicken, and those were bought out by Kentucky Fried Chicken. So he was in that weird position, and this you wouldn't find today, where he was allowed to franchise both Burger King and Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Okay. I always knew that Burger King was Miami-based because as a family, we used to go to it and go to the outskirts of Miami International Airport and watch the planes take off and land on Sundays. But anyway, thanks a lot for the information. You are a very informative, and I like the report. Thank you.
Obliged, retired firefighter. If other folks have a question that they want to get in, *61. It kind of goes back to, we were talking about Sisters Chicken and Biscuits, and in a system of racism, white supremacy, if you have white dominated fast food chains, restaurants, if they decide we want to market to black people, it's very easy to say, hey, we're going to play hip hop music, or, you know, we'll change the uniforms in this neighborhood so now you all can wear kente cloth, and, you know, we'll put up some pictures of Dr. King, or we'll change sister, maybe we'll spell it with an A, and, you know, it's very easy to kind of do these things if you say, hey, we want to market to black people to get some of their money. You write, Coretta Scott King, it's Black History Month. Coretta Scott King hoped that the King holiday would provide workers with a day off and properly commemorate her husband's commitment to labor struggle. Instead, the King holiday became a prime opportunity to sell apolitical ideals like colorblindness, which obscures the vicious impacts of racism on people's lives and livelihood. The further the nation moved from King's death and the aftermath, the more King and the movement he led became uncontroversial markers of the past. Even can just be used to hawk a Big Mac. I'm skipping a few pages over. Fast food is about more than just food. Consumers make marketplace choices based on a constellation of emotions, past experiences, memories, desires, and actual hunger. At any moment, one of these impulses can dictate whether a person drives south to a Hardee's or north to a Wendy's or home to cook. The fast food industry invests millions upon millions of dollars each year to better understand how this psychology of buying works to create business models that convince customers that their burritos, chicken tenders, and hot fudge sundaes can meet whatever needs that propel a person to their restaurant. Brilliant passage, I thought, because that can even mean, if that means fooling you into thinking that we care about black people, we got that covered too. Your thoughts?
Absolutely. I mean, here's the thing. Anytime we believe that we're smarter than the marketers and the advertisers, they'll do something and we're like, damn, they got us again this time. It's really hard to resist these messages because they aren't haphazardly put together. They're responding to very real struggles, real joys, real, you know, ups and downs of life. And so I think that the answer is that we are just conscientious of what we're engaging with, why we are making the choices we are making, and understand that that's part of being a thoughtful citizen. And the more and more we practice that ideal, the less and less I think we feel sucked in to this idea that we don't have many choices.
Our caller in South Carolina, non-Clemson grad. Did you have a question for Dr. Chatelain?
Hi, Gus. Hi, everyone. This is Miss C.
Greetings, Miss C. Good to hear from you.
Thank you. I thoroughly enjoyed this broadcast and all of the McDonald's video clips leading up to the broadcast. My question is, how would the guest define a black-owned business? Because that has been up for debate with a lot of people that I talk to. So I would like to know her definition or anybody else's definition for a black-owned business. Like, how can we define that?
I think that's a good question. I would respond to that by saying a black-owned business is a business that is operated by black owners and is in the interest of thinking about the market conditions that often keep black people out. But with that, I would also say, when we talk about supporting black-owned businesses, I always want to say why. Is it because we feel more comfortable supporting black people in an endeavor? Or do we believe that black business, by the very nature of being a black business, is ultimately going to do good? Because I think that second assumption is really hard because that's not always necessarily true. I think that it's important to hold all businesses accountable. And I think just because a business is a black-owned business doesn't mean it's necessarily committed to enhancing the quality of life of black people.
Excellent. this has been up for debate among our acquaintances and some of our colleagues because there are some black-owned businesses where the key person is a black person or non-white black person, but they are married to a white person or in a tragic arrangement with a white person. And normally it's too much to try to think about like who they're sleeping with or who they're married to and to consider all that stuff. But you know, at the end of the day, that their white partner, even though they may have nothing to do with the business, they technically still own it. So is there like a percentage? Should we say 51%? Or it needs to be all key members need to be black people or need to be committed to the black community and enhancing the quality of life and, you know, providing high quality services to the black community and all people in general. So that was just some of the confusion among our groups. It's like, if this person is in a tragic arrangement with a white person, you know, do we still consider them a Black-owned business? Do we still support them?
I mean, I think that every person makes a decision on how they want to engage in the marketplace. The only thing I would say is, regardless of the race of the person who owns a business, I guess we have to be really careful about what we think business does for civil society or for the public good. Because although I think it's important for people to have an opportunity to open a business if that's what they want, I really caution us against investing too much in business at the expense of our public resources and the public good. Because at the end of the day, business is concerned with its profits over people, and the public good is all about investing in people and not just seeing their value as, you know, related to profits.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
If other folks, if you have a question that you want to ask Dr. Chatelain, go ahead and get your hand up. We'll let her enjoy the rest of her evening. Unless you have a question, you can get your hand up in the next minute or so. I did want to make sure, this is such a great quote you included from James Foreman, former member of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, as was Julian Bond. James Foreman, he wrote Making of Black Revolutionaries, some other great works as well. You quoted him from the spring of 1969, and this is talking about this thought, because I still hear it like now, 2020, very often, that black capitalism, black economics, that's what's going to solve it. We just get more black entrepreneurs. That's what's going to save the day. And Foreman, you quoting him, Foreman wrote, "We must separate ourselves from those Negroes who go around the country promoting all types of schemes for black capitalism. Ironically, the most militant black nationalists, as they call themselves, have been the first to jump on the bandwagon of black capitalism. They are pimps, black power pimps, and fraudulent leaders, and the people must be educated to understand that any black man or Negro who is advocating a perpetuation of capitalism inside the United States is in fact seeking not only his ultimate destruction and death, but is contributing to the continuous exploitation of black people around the world." Quite a quote. Why did you include those lines?
Because I wanted to highlight the fact that while there was a lot of energy and enthusiasm over black-owned businesses and excitement about the possibility of, you know, black franchising, there were people who were also movement people who said, let's be very careful about what we're signing up for, and that our freedom being tied to the inequality of capitalism is not sufficient. It's not going to work. And so I really appreciated, you know, Foreman's words and other people who said, like, let's really think about what we are trying, what burning house we're trying to integrate into, and perhaps imagine a different way of, you know, charting a path toward freedom.
Context of White Supremacy. Again, our guest, Dr. Marcia Chatelain. We've been discussing the book Franchise, The Golden Arches in Black America. Folks listening in, any of the other callers, questions they want to make sure they get in while we have Dr. Chatelain?
Yes, can I be heard again?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I heard briefly the conversation about the idea at McDonald's where black males use it as a social environment. And I hold that to be, have some accuracy to it, in my experiences, in two different places. One is in the area where I'm sitting at right now. Does the guests have, any insight on that, on why that takes place in McDonald's with black males in around 60, 70 years old?
Yeah. I mean, I attribute it to the fact that we don't have a robust commitment to senior citizen centers in our country. And so where else can you sit and have cheap coffee but McDonald's? And you see this in a lot of communities across the color line. And again, I have no problem with people going to see their friends at a McDonald's, but what I want more than anything else is for that McDonald's to not be the only place for senior citizens to spend time with each other, that there should be public resources that allow, you know, people to do that very thing. And so I think it's interesting how McDonald's, again, doesn't just exist as a place to get something to drink. It becomes the center of people's social lives. But the second that McDonald's doesn't want those folks in there, you start to see, you know, the limits of using a business for those purposes.
Right. Thank you.
I think another component, since it's 2020, Wi-Fi, I think for a lot of Black people, and even for a lot of Black people in areas, they don't have Wi-Fi. Sometimes McDonald's, that might be the closest and most accessible option, you know, to go and use Wi-Fi if you have to write a paper or look for a job or whatever. You're going to, for younger people and older people, that might be the best option. So there can be, that goes exactly to the point, why is it that McDonald's is my best and only option for Wi-Fi, to sit and chat with a friend for a coffee? To get a butt, like, why is that? Like, why is that my best? Where in Seattle, you would have a lot of other options. In fact, I was even thinking of my high school. A McDonald's was a block from the high school. It was so close, you could, and people did, you could leave. We had like a 35-minute lunch break. It was so close, you could easily leave and probably take a casual stroll to McDonald's and eat lunch and be back in time, you know, without being late. That would not be possible at any of the high schools, I think, in Seattle. I'm trying to think in my brain, but that would not be possible. And there were a number of schools that were super, super close to McDonald's. And just I was thinking of his question. We were not seniors, but that was the hangout spot because it was right next to the school. Like, you could get there, like, it was 5 minutes and, oh yeah, we could get, you know, an ice cream cone or an apple pie or a Big Mac or, you know, whatever. Or we could just hang out. And yeah. And that is so huge in terms of tailoring your tastes for life, what you're eating and that beautiful passage you have about memories and experiences and all these other things. And then at the end, hunger that can motivate or why we, you know, pursue a particular meal, piling up all those experiences. And, oh, this is where we used to hang out and have all that fun. I'll stop by and reminisce. And food is a powerful McDonald's. White people understand the psychology of food. Our caller on the Skype line. Did you have a question for Dr. Chatelain?
Hi, can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Hi, doctor, I just wanted to know, like, your book also talks about, like, the impact of those franchises on Black people's health, of how we may have, like, high instances of obesity and diabetes. Could you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that we know is that Black people suffer from higher rates of illnesses that are associated with diet and lifestyle, so hypertension, diabetes, and other conditions that can be reversed with the adoption of a healthier diet. I think that part of what I wanted to talk about in writing this book is to say, like, there's nothing natural or normal about these disparities, that there is a pathway to them. And that pathway has been the hyper-concentration of fast food in these communities, which has been underwritten and supported by a number of forces. And so if we're serious about combating, you know, the consequences of this unhealthy food, then we have to be ready to really talk about capitalism, about the quality of people's lives, about jobs, and about all the non-food issues in people's lives as well.
Yeah, because I've heard Gus talk about the food deserts. I didn't really understood really what that means. Have you heard of that?
Absolutely. And so this book really tries to put a historical context on how the food desert emerged. Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Get a last passage in before we allowed Dr. Chatelain to get back to promoting her book. She writes, this isn't the conclusion of Franchise. We must all remain vigilant in the places that the industry appears, where students go to school, where families worship, where young athletes demonstrate their talents, where the elderly monitor their blood glucose levels, where high school students proudly collect their scholarship checks, where a formerly incarcerated person is able to work, where Martin Luther King Jr.'s legacy is commemorated, and where children play on weekends. In each of these spaces where the funds from the industry flows, food justice activists must imagine a world in which public funds, community investment dollars, and collective energies sustain them. Vigilance, being mindful. It has been a pleasure, Dr. Chatelain. Thoroughly enjoyed the text and reminiscing on McDonald's commercials. I wish you the best with the book tour. Hope you make lots of sales. Be safe in your travels. And again, thank you so much for being so gracious with your time this evening.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Take good care. Context of White Supremacy. Book we are reading for Thursday, Packing Them In, An Archaeology of Environmental Racism in Chicago, 1865 to 1954, written by Sylvia Hood Washington. Looking forward to it. I guess McDonald's couldn't be in this, too early, but I'm very excited to get more information on exactly what the plan was. Again, white people are not ignorant about white supremacy, racism, at all. Preparing for that, she has a section here on, well, she has many parts to deal with Chicago, but one specifically with environmental racism, what we should be talking about this coming Thursday. Let's see. Oh, here we go. In the spring of 1974 in Chicago, residents of the Altgeld Gardens Homes public housing development observed a strange cloud lingering over the complex, which housed 2,000 families, bordered by factories and a landfill. The Altgeld Gardens community had long been exposed to chemical hazards from neighboring plants. This eerie gray sight in the sky was the result of a silicon tetrachloride leak from a nearby chemical company. A breach in a 500,000-gallon storage tank caused hydrochloric acid to mix with moisture in the air and gather above the Southside neighborhood. The acid made the residents susceptible to respiratory and gastrointestinal problems, especially children, pregnant women, the elderly, and people with asthma and bronchitis. Everybody, basically. Many in the garden residents reported feeling a burning sensation in their throats and used towels, handkerchiefs, and whatever cloth they could find to cover their mouths and noses. 50 people were taken to the hospital for the day. A University of Illinois toxicologist advised the state's branch of the Environmental Protection Agency to begin evacuating the housing site in the late afternoon, but officials delayed the process for hours. Concerned residents called the police, who had little to offer by way of advice. When one resident called for help, she realized her actions were in vain. They didn't send anyone. If I'd known what this was, I could have been ready to take my family out of here. They should have told us what would have been, they should have told us so we would have been ready. Eventually, the city dispatched public transit buses and police vehicles to Altgeld Gardens to start the evacuation process. Some residents were unsure if they should leave, fearing that their homes would be robbed if they were gone for the night. The mayor dispatched patrols to watch over the garden homes. The only thing that residents could depend on was a meal from McDonald's. Yes, system of white supremacy. You can bank on a happy meal. Incidentally, I will say for the McDonald's All-American game, that was one I was going to ask because that's what it's called. It's the All-American game. I am race. Dr. Welsing, she said that anagram. I am race in America, but it's called the All-American Game, McDonald's All-American Game. Masterstroke of advertising. I think Miss C, she was looking at some of the commercials, McDonald's commercials that I posted, and she said to be able to link your favorite sport, basketball, with your favorite player in any era with your favorite restaurant. And that has become such an iconic event. Like I said, now that's on, I don't even know how many views the, I guess it's from 2 years ago, from 2018, when Zion Williamson was in the McDonald's All-American game. But I suspect millions of views. Branding, branding, branding. Michael Jordan, Kobe Bryant, anybody, Shaquille O'Neal, anybody, Kevin Garnett. Last, as I said, Candace Parker, it's not just males. Last 40 years, you can go back their senior year in high school and see them wearing the Golden Arch, hanging out with Ronald McDonald, maybe doing a slam dunk or shooting a three-pointer or something cool related to basketball. Branding. And then, why are black people the Gospel Fest? I had no idea. They've been doing this for 40 years. I learned quite a bit and thought about things quite a bit differently just studying the McDonald's commercials alone. Fascinating, seeing some of the advertisements and the way that the black people are depicted. They have one spot. They have a black male and a black female, and they're quarreling in the kitchen at breakfast time. They're burning the toast and all the rest. And so they just, we'll just go to McDonald's. And they get to McDonald's, and magically they get along, and they're hugging and smooching and everything. And simultaneously they're showing a white man, and he is like reading the newspaper and all that. He's got his hard hat on, blue collar fella, they say. And so he goes to McDonald's, and he gets his cup of coffee and his Egg McMuffin so he can read the paper and not have to worry about making breakfast or anything. So this white man and the black couple, they leave. The black male, he goes to open the door for the black female so that she can get in the vehicle. As the black male closes the door, the white man comes and he opens his door. They're parked right next to each other. The white man comes and opens his door, opens it, and knocks the black male, hits him so hard that it knocks the black male through the passenger window. Knocks him through the passenger window off his feet a little bit. The black guy digs himself out of the car, gets back on his feet, turns around to kind of look at this white man, and that's how the commercial ends. Got to be some violence against black people. But like it's fascinating just studying the different marketing techniques. As she said, you'll see a lot of gospel music throughout the years, hip hop music, the double dutch, as she said, the way that they will market to black people. It's fascinating when people say that white people are ignorant about white supremacy racism. That is not supported by evidence. This is a great illustration. They study black people. They might even call in a team of black people and pay them to help them study black people. Very important to remember that as we move. And again, I always like it when we get reports where it is not green. It is not about cash. We can get confused about that. It is white supremacy racism that dominates everything. Racists frequently can make it seem as though the primary motivation is finances, money. That is not the case. It is practicing white supremacy racism. With that, I guess the last quick point I'll get in, those empowerment zones, that was a key point when we're talking about the land and how much territory, physical territory, McDonald's has acquired. They got a lot of that subsidized on the cheap. They would have these what they call disturbances after the assassination of Dr. King, or the trial in the beating of Rodney King, or whatever the incident is. I say, okay, we will, if you go into the Negro area and open a business, we'll give you huge tax breaks and that sort of thing. McDonald's has consistent, and other fast food establishments have consistently taken advantage and benefited from those tax breaks and whatever gifts, benefits, mooching they call it, government mooching, to come in and build these fast food burger joints in areas where black people are warehoused. Financing white supremacy racism, very common. Anywho, if other folks who are with us, if you have any thoughts, comments on what was shared during the broadcast. Oh, make sure I get in again. The Cow's Yoga Retreat. No Big Macs there. No McDonald's. No fast food. plant-based meals every day, yoga every day. We'll have our food workshops. We'll have counter-racist workshops as we visit Toronto May 21 through May 24. Deadline to register is this Saturday, February 29th. Drop an email if you have questions, concerns, need more information. The number 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. *61 if you have thoughts or questions. Folks that are with us, anyone, thoughts from what they heard during the broadcast? Still marinating. We can reflect on your, McDonald's experience, if you like. They have so many. They do such a good job. I think it's kind of a common, it's a cliche, they say, getting to the brain and getting to the child at an early age, that can be successful for concepts, or if you want to really get someone to commit to a certain way of thinking or behavior for a long period of time, to try to reach them with that concept when they are very, very young. McDonald's has done this well for about 50 years in a variety of ways. One I forgot, I think, to retired firefighters' question about the older black people. I think he said older black males or older black people, why they kind of hang out in McDonald's together. I said, you know, Wi-Fi, which he said, you might not have a community center where you could go and do this. So McDonald's, hey, you can go get a cheap cup of coffee and hang out, read the paper, talk for a while. They have playgrounds at McDonald's for a lot of black children. You don't have easy access to nice, well-funded play sites where you can go and run around and do all that, and you don't have easy access to go get out and hike, where you could go and be on a nice lush field and, you know, roll around and do all that stuff, streams and all that. If you don't have access, McDonald's, that might be the closest play option. And I know that to be the case for some folks, where, hey, that's what to do. You know, we just pack up the kids, pack up the children, go to McDonald's and, you know, do 30 minutes, an hour, what have you, and let them do the balls and all that stuff. And then, you know, maybe they get a happy meal on the way out. All of that is branding your brain computer with those experiences. If it's hanging out there for a birthday party, if it's hanging out there in the playpen thing, if it's going to get the food and being with your parents, it might not even be about the food per se, but just that experience of being there with your parents, family member, and all that goes with that. It's a lot of psychology that goes on with that experience. White people study this in depth and refine, pay lots of people to get those think tanks to come in and study all of this. So it's very powerful in terms of the hangout and what would draw you to come to that environment. Just the sometimes those memories, like I said before, of hanging out there, we've been going out for so many reasons. I was going here when I was 10 and 8 and 5 to, you know, do the playpen thing. And then we were going to hang out here to get food after school. And then, you know, like Wi-Fi, you know, had to go there to get Wi-Fi. Didn't have another reliable source to go get that. I mean, it would be so many reasons that would draw you back to McDonald's or a similar, probably, fast food type of franchise that would be available in an area with a lot of black people, not a lot of resources. Very, very common, and all by design in the system of white supremacy.
Can I be heard?
Retired firefighter?
Yes. Primarily what I notice is exclusively black males. Also, another thing I notice is McDonald's, and they are represented by the caricature of Ronald McDonald, is business-wise is connected with historical black colleges. Every year, I think since the 1980s, the game that comes on the major channels between Southern University and Grambling State University, college that I attended for grad school, the famous game that they have, the Bayou Classic. I noticed Ronald McDonald at the games. So there has to be some sort of business connection, I would assume, with McDonald's and those two institutions. And they're pretty much in with other games, I would assume, that comes, that ends up coming on television in some sort of way.
Absolutely. I think McDonald's, I think it's a number of beer companies. I think she talked about Anheuser-Busch and some of the others that have sponsored similar types of events, the sporting events, or the gospel concert that she talked about, music festival type things, black music festivals, I'm talking about black sporting events. It's very, and that's why the cigarette industry is another one, Newport, where they'll sponsor these type of things. I have not seen something where it's like organic produce industry is sponsoring, you know, a black literary event or something of that nature, or even one of these basketball tournaments or something. I have not seen that. It's consistently what I just said, alcohol, cigarettes, fast food, something that'll kill you. And then they say, wow, I wonder why black people have this relationship. A lot of those events, they get to sell their food. I don't know. I haven't been to the Bayou Classic, but I know they do have concessions at a lot of those sporting activities. I would be really surprised if McDonald's didn't have some sort of booth or something set up somewhere to get a hamburger or a french fry in somebody's mouth. Like, I guess, you know, they could have whatever food at the event, but I mean, all of that is thought out in design, in advance to support the system. And just to say, they do a lot of that. Like those sporting events, they'll have McDonald's, they'll sponsor the Bayou Classic and the All-American Game. They sponsor the Olympics. They'll get, you know, Olympic athletes to come and do the pose thing. Is this? Oh, yeah, it is. So you'll see this summer, you'll see them do the Olympic thing. If you don't see it already, you'll see their Olympic spots, and they'll go get, you know, different athletes and what have you to come, Simone Biles or whoever, to come and pose with their little gold medals and do their thing and all that nonsense, which is, talk about deception. You are not going to be some world-class athlete sitting around eating chicken nuggets. Like, that is the greatest nonsense. Like, they will go and pay people who would never touch a chicken nugget. They will go and pay them millions of dollars to come and hawk their products to black people. When you, you're trying to be a world-class athlete, you're thinking you're going to be somebody at the Olympics this summer, doing some swimming, doing some equestrian, doing some relay, not eating Big Macs. That's not how it goes. You better go back and get in the organic produce line. And they do a lot of that, where they'll go get athletes and folks who you have to do a lot of being mindful and vigilant in what you eat and training to take care of your body, not eating that nonsense that's available. People that are generally the people that are, that they would be getting, as I said, they wouldn't even touch it. They would have chefs and be meticulous about what they're going to eat, what they're going to drink. Not, yeah. Anywho, other folks, any other folks with observations, questions from what they heard, the broadcast, Dr. Chatelain's franchise? She is credited, Dr. Chatelain, credited with starting the hashtag Ferguson Syllabus. Said she started the book with the protests that were happening after the murder of Michael Brown Jr. In 2014. But the hashtag, if folks recall, it had a lot of information, again, to contextualize the shooting. It was very popular. I remember that from back then. The other folks satisfied, or anything else they wanted to make sure they get in?
Last thought, I did remember, as she mentioned, after the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King's murder, and this thought came up about capitalism, that James Brown, he tried to start a restaurant chain, and Muhammad Ali also. One of them was, one of my Muhammad Ali's franchises was in Miami-Dade County And that was my only time ever seeing him. And neither one lasted no more than probably less than a year, as far as that concerned. You know, and I guess what took place was, is what I think she was talking about, whereas the black people would just buy the franchises of the McDonald's or the Burger Kings. I believe Magic Johnson owns at least two McDonald's down here in Miami-Dade County, from what I understand.
Yeah. She discusses both of those franchises in the book. In fact, she writes, Soul, S-O-U-L, was hard to define precisely, but fast food marketers were hopeful that black customers could recognize it when they saw it in their attempts to reach black diners. In the late 1960s, black celebrities lent their names and likeness to a number of businesses. These franchises suggested that they were truly black-owned and, in their spokesperson's authentic soulfulness, better poised to make black consumers happy and even improve black communities. All of these short-lived efforts failed because the brands were built on unstable foundations. Sometimes insufficient capital and poor planning led to a business closure. A few years after Mahalia Jackson's Glory Fried Chicken was introduced in 1968, the business folded. The company's masterminds, two white lawyers from Nashville, structured it like a Ponzi scheme. That's generally some sort of fraud is the word they would use for that. Ponzi fraud, they call it. Muhammad Ali's Miami-based Champ Burger, also introduced in 1968, only lasted a couple years. Friend of black capitalism and singer James Brown launched the Gold Platter Restaurant franchise in 1969, which later spun off into a convenience store concept. After he convinced his fans that franchising would be his brand new bag, the restaurant closed its few locations. Each of these companies assured black customers that in choosing the Negro Songbird, the Greatest, or the Godfather of Soul over Ronald, the Colonel, or the Burger King, they were choosing to not only support a black business, but they were also celebrating their own blackness. The collapse of each of these ventures animated the issue taken up by the Dairy Queen protesters that surrounded Julie. And then I already read that portion where she just repeats, there were truly few black businesses between the time the first business plan was drafted and the moment the first profit collected. One could encounter white financiers, white franchising representatives, white federal agency heads, or white French fry distribution company owners. If one could not buy black authentically, then the very least a black customer could do was look for products tinged with soul. But that's the all of the franchises listed system of whites, and even listing, even Mahalia Jackson, coined by two white lawyers. Ponzi scheme, they call it. Very common. Keep that in mind. We get to workplace racism. Again, not saying don't go into business, but all of this is very, very common. Even 2020, this is why we have to get rid of the system. You're not going to be able to have, quote unquote, successful black-owned. This seems like you can't even get a definition of what that means. That seems to further support you're not going to be able to have successful black businesses in a system of white supremacy. It's just not possible. Anything else folks need to make sure they get in? Folks satisfied? We will assume folks are good. We should be here Thursday. Sylvia Hood packing them in, focusing specifically, exclusively on Dr. Welsing's Chicago. Looking forward to picking that up Thursday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Again, the CO.W.S. Counter-Racist Yoga Retreat deadline to register is this Saturday. $400 non-refundable deposit gets you signed up May 21 through May 24th. That is a Thursday through Sunday. Yoga every day. Plant-based meals every day. Counter-racist workshops. Food workshops. Looking forward to having some amazing veggie dishes Great conversation and just enjoying, hopefully, a cooperative spring, late spring. Get that in, cooperative late spring weather in Toronto. Drop an email if you have questions, need details, untiljustice@gmail.com. If anything, hopefully we don't have listeners who are eating McDonald's, but I know it's powerful. I have eaten a lot of McDonald's in my life. Hopefully we can do better. Be vigilant, as she said, to make better choices. I don't think any of us needs to be eating McDonald's, anything there. I think we can make better food choices if it means thinking ahead, planning ahead, cooking, doing a little more, preparing meals on our own. All of that would be better than allowing race soldiers to continue to place items in our mouth, on our plate. McDonald's, and helping us see, wow, McDonald's, major component in a myriad of ways, major component in the system of racism, white supremacy. I am not going to invest in this franchise, black owned or whatever that means. I am not going to invest in this franchise. I will make better meal choices. Do more cooking. That would, you know, be grand as well. Do more cooking. Do more cooking. Do more cooking. Counter racist yoga retreat. We'll be doing more cooking. With that, much obliged for folks who participated live or archive. Hope it's worthy of your time and energy. Sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. We have enough attacks on our brain computer with bad food and smog and poisoned water and everything else. At minimum, I am not going to add any extra unnecessary poisons in my body. In addition to being sober, let's be buckled up every time we are in a vehicle, passenger or driver. If you are driving, you are sober, you are buckled, and you are not on the phone. Again, just trying to do little things that we can to keep ourselves as safe as possible under conditions designed to be unsafe, especially for black people. With that, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cal signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.